Welcome, everyone. We still have some people joining us from the waiting room. So while people are being let in, we'll just kind of let you get situated here. And we've got just a few little housekeeping tips to help make things go smoothly today. One of them is that you'll notice we have transcription running on the bottom for those of you who prefer that. But typically, you can toggle that on or off in your own view. So if you would like to turn that off, you're welcome to do so as well. So for today, as you may have noticed, the meeting is being recorded and we will post this after the event. So if you missed a portion or if you know somebody else who might be interested, you're welcome to share that and we'll have it on the college YouTube channel and our series playlist following the event. Let's see here. As always, we ask you to keep your microphone muted unless you're speaking. That'll just keep our audio quality high for everyone. And if you have a question or an idea to share at any point during the event, we invite you to put those into the chat section of the meeting today. And our moderators today, it's Abby Asojo and Virajita Singh, and they will be monitoring that and they'll respond and they'll call on people or share questions throughout the event at various times. For those of you who are interested in a certificate or continuing education, the program was approved for one AIA learning unit, health, safety, and welfare, and you must attend at least 60 minutes of this session in order to qualify for that credit. Certificates and the AIA credits will be emailed or posted within about a week, maybe sooner. All right, with that, let's start to introduce our series hosts and speakers for today. Those of you who have been attending will recognize our fabulous hosts and the founders or creators of this series. Abby Asojo is our Associate Dean for Research, Creative Scholarship, and Engagement at the College of Design, and she's also Professor of Interior Design. Today, our discussion host is Tom Fisher, our Director of the Minnesota Design Center, and Dayton Hudson, Chair in Urban Design with the College of Design. And also, we have Virajita Singh, who will be hosting on chat, and Virajita is our Associate Vice Provost for the Office of Equity and Diversity, and she's also a Research Fellow with the College. Our featured discussion leaders for today are Richard Graves, not in the speaking order, by the way, according to this slide. Richard Graves is the Director of the Center for Sustainable Building Research with the College of Design at the University of Minnesota. And our chat hosts will be sharing their bios in the chat. So if you would like a little more information, you can read about them more there. Our next speaker is Elizabeth Turner. She's an architect, planner, and passive building consultant. She's also the founder of Precipitate. And our third speaker is Shengyin Xu, and she is a global sustainability manager with the World Resource Institute. So very happy to have you all joining us today. I'm going to turn it over to Tom Fisher to take us into the event.
Great. Thank you, Lori. Thanks everyone for coming on this, the 51st Earth Day, which started back in 1970. I think there are a lot of things to look forward to on this Earth Day. As you probably read, the Biden administration today is having discussions with world leaders around environmental issues related to carbon. He announced that he wants to achieve to halve our carbon emissions in the U.S. by 2030 with the goal of getting to net zero by 2050. And for those of you who have heard about the infrastructure bill that he's proposed, he calls for things such as pausing oil and gas drilling on federal land, remaking the U.S. power grid around renewables, installing 500,000 charging stations, incentivizing the shift in our car fleet to electric vehicles by the government purchasing electric vehicles from now on. And so there are many things I think that we can look forward to. And I think we've also all experienced the environmental impacts of this pandemic. A lot of these, were accidental because of a global economic shutdown. But there was one study at Stanford University, for example, that showed how 20 times more lives were saved in Chinese cities because of reduced air pollution than the number of people who were actually killed by COVID-19. And there have been other studies that have shown, for example, that during the last year, the pandemic year, levels of air pollution in New York were reduced by nearly 50%. And there was a nearly 50% reduction in nitrous oxide and carbon monoxide in Chinese cities because of the shutdown of heavy industry. And so there were quite a lot of positive benefits of the pandemic. And the conversation we want to have with all of you is, how can we make some of these benefits permanent? Because there is also evidence that we may be going back to pre-pandemic levels on some of these issues. So, for example, even though the daily global carbon emissions were down last year by 17%, there was a recent study that said that it's only about 5% lower than at this same point in 2019, even though normal activity, economic activity, hasn't fully restarted. And so it isn't as low as I think we had all thought it was. And there's some worry that we could see a surge back to pre-pandemic levels, as happened after the Great Recession in 2007 and 2008. I think there's also concern around transportation, for example, a worry about social distancing and public transportation. A Vanderbilt University study recently anticipates the possibility of what they call a car apocalypse, where they actually see the potential of many more people driving because they're afraid to get back into public transportation. And already in China, traffic is back to pre-pandemic levels, even though the economy has yet to sort of fully recover. And so I think the challenge that we all face is that we had a lot of these accidental benefits because of the pandemic related to the environment. And then how can we make them permanent? How can we make sure that they're equitable? And how are they connected to other social benefits? And that's really the question that we want to all explore with all of you in this hour. And so with that, you've already had our three speakers introduced, but why don't we start with you, Elizabeth Turner, and we'll look forward to your thoughts. So Elizabeth, go ahead.
Great, thanks so much, Tom. I'm so excited to be here today. And thank you for the host for putting this together. I wanted to step back for a moment and talk about kind of how I have experienced COVID from my lens as a woman, a small business owner who has 5 employees that just happen to be women, and as an instructor and as someone who lives with several chronic health conditions. So I think one of the interesting things when we talk about COVID impacts is that we're all experiencing it differently and we all have different stories to tell. So looking forward to connecting with you in the breakout rooms as well. So when the pandemic happened, I was in the middle of an amazing class at the University of Minnesota. I teach the capstone for the Sustainability Studies minor, and we do a community engagement project. And in 2020, I was able to partner with Dr. Michelle Garvey, who is a local scholar of environmental justice. And we were working with a community in South Minneapolis known as the African American Wall Street, really strong and vibrant in the 60s, had a lot of impacts, was divided in two by 35W, has fewer street trees, which we know means that it's 10 degrees hotter than the A redlined, the non-redlined districts, because it was a redlined area in Minneapolis. And the community was going through a planning process and wanted to work with our students to figure out how we could design resilience hubs. So we had a lot of engagement activities planned. We're so excited, most diverse and engaged group of students I'd ever seen. And then we were told we weren't going to be meeting in person anymore. And what that meant for the community, who had prior to that been very engaged, was they went into survival mode. They couldn't connect with us. What it meant for my students is that students were equally engaged in the classroom. Suddenly, all of the inequities in their home situations and backgrounds were really visible. And some people could be engaged much more than others who had to kind of drop out. So for me, the biggest environmental change that I've seen in the pandemic is that these inequities in our systems and in our society are more visible than we ever have, than they have been before. So even though we were talking about environmental justice with our students, like actually seeing that happen in the community where we were working was really, took it from the academic side to the like actual experiential side and was more powerful. So we ended the semester without any community engagement, which felt like a big loss. And then a week after that happened, George Floyd was murdered in the community where we were working with our students. And I think I can't really separate environmental benefits from environmental justice. And it's been a really difficult summer wrestling with all of those and how you engage with community and what it means to be resilient and what it means to have environmental benefits. And this quote is from All We Can Save, and I think actually Virajita was the first person to share it with me. Really gave me the hope for the first time when it came out in September of 2020. So I'm just gonna read it for you because I think it brought together a lot of the things that I've been feeling and is the biggest lesson for me really in COVID. So the same patriarchal power structure that oppresses and exploits girls, women, and non-binary people and constricts and contorts boys and men also wreaks destruction on the natural world. Dominance, supremacy, violence, extraction, egotism, greed, ruthless competition. These hallmarks of patriarchy fuel the climate crisis just as surely as they do inequality, colluding with racism along the way. So the book is the stories of 60 women and many people of color and Black women who are working for climate justice. And that's the thing coming out of COVID for me that gives me the most hope. So next slide. And I think really our job is to determine, you know, what are the issues and kind of what solutions do we want to be solving for and who's engaged. So one of the inequities in our system that's more visible is we know that compared to white Americans, Indigenous, Pacific Islander, Latino, and Black folks are dying at higher rates. And so many of these things we know. If you've read an article about environmental justice, you know that health impacts are so tied to environmental justice. And I don't think we can separate the death rates of COVID-19 from those environmental justice impacts. So environmental justice started in 1982 when people began to realize that sources of pollution were more likely to be located in communities of color and started to do research and work to change that and impact it. A few more statistics, and I'll post these in the chat during the Q&A, the sources. So in a Philadelphia study of renters, 22% have been forced to move by landlords during the pandemic. And in those primarily African-American neighborhoods where people were forced to move, there was a 3 times higher rate of death of COVID. In March 2020, unemployment rose nationally to 14%, but 21% was among those with less than a high school diploma, while only 8% with a bachelor's degree. And 4 times as many women dropped out of the workforce versus men during the pandemic. So a lot of these statistics that we have now related from this year tell us so much about kind of how the structure of our systems are set up. And they were that way before COVID and they'll be that way after, but we have a lot more data now to know how these systems are operating and we can make different choices. So next slide. So in March 2020, I also started a resilience planning process with Bemidji State University. And we had a lot of like really engaging in-person events planned with music and art and food, and none of that could happen. So instead we had an opportunity to meet directly with groups. And you can see here how many different organizations we've met with as a resilience planning team. And this couldn't have happened if I was driving up to Bemidji. So there's a lot of wonderful things that Zoom has allowed us to engage with. But we'd also know we're missing a lot of people. So if you go to the next slide, the kind of the inequities in our system about access to broadband have been really highlighted too. So we're not reaching everybody we want to be reaching during these conversations about resilience. So we're not getting their ideas about what resilience could look like. And the way we're trying to combat that is to talking to heads of organizations that have boots on the ground and are doing social work and engagement with communities who might not be able to have as much access to internet, but still trying to get their voices filtered through. So some benefits and some difficulties, but we're making it work in the ways that we can. So next slide, then how does this translate to environmental impacts? So for me, the biggest tie in the way we can start to restructure our systems to increase equity and resilience across all of these disparities is I've been focusing on passive house and energy efficiency and affordable housing. And this is a slide I've shown for many years. And one of the benefits is that when we have a high performance building envelope, with lots of thermal comfort, moisture control, and durability. We also have fresh air requirements. So we have continuous ventilation with energy recovery, and that's huge. It used to be nobody understood what energy recovery was or how ventilation could possibly be tied to health outcomes. Well, now I think everybody understands the importance of ventilation for health outcomes. So this has been a big win that I've seen environmentally from the pandemic, just people's awareness of the role of ventilation. And so if you go to the next slide, I think it's really important to think about if we increase ventilation, that's healthier for people, but we're causing ourselves a huge environmental crisis if we don't also think about energy recovery. And I spoke with an engineer this week, and he says, you know, like 99% of projects don't have energy recovery and ventilation. So taking this energy model that I did for Westside Flats in St. Paul of affordable housing, what you see on the bottom is the energy, the kind of the heat loss from different systems. So you can see mechanical ventilation in teal is about a third of the heat loss from the system with an energy recovery ventilator that's 80% efficient. And that it uses 17 kBTUs per square foot of energy per year. If the only thing we change is that we remove that energy recovery system, keep the ventilation rates the same, that jumps to almost two thirds of heat loss from mechanical ventilation, and we're using 25 kBTUs per square foot per year. So we're kind of setting ourselves up for our buildings to use a lot more energy post-pandemic, but we could, if we're looking at energy recovery instead, have with one simple device, a really great win-win for people's health, as well as more increased energy efficiency in our affordable housing. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Elizabeth. And Shengyin, do you want to go next?
Yes, thanks, Tom. And thanks, Virajita, Lori, Abby, for having me. It's wonderful to see some of the folks on the line too. The names are familiar. My name is Shengyin Xu. I'm the Global Sustainability Manager at World Resources Institute. And I work with our network of staff experts across 12 different countries, as well as a network of other NGOs and IGOs in the same environmental space. And we're all collectively raising our organizational ambitions on sustainability. And so today I'm just going to give a brief sample of some of the projects that we're working on that hint at or point at what the post-pandemic world may look like. Next slide, please. So one of the everyday things that we do that's based on some of the work from our food team is working to shift diets globally. And so we have an internal food policy that requires US events to be all vegetarian. But in our adaptation across our global offices, we also encourage local context to influence the behavioral shifts. So our China office has taken a slightly different approach with Meatless Mondays. India and Indonesia have avoided doing red meat, which is a higher GHG emission per gram of protein impact. And Brazil has really focused on local plant-rich foods that highlight some of the plants that are native to that region. And so really the goal of the food campaign and our work is not to make everyone do vegetarian diets all the time, but really to convince a wider swath of the population to change one or two days and to avoid some high impact choices during the week. So really learning from behavioral science and finding ways to embed low carbon lifestyle in every day and amongst a lot of people. Next slide. Same for waste. When we first started out, even though we're an environmental organization, we had a huge recycling problem. We had to actually spend quite a few months convincing folks to throw some things away because the recycling was becoming so contaminated. And it was over the course of several years and different types of campaigns that we're now able to do composting across a number of our global offices, taking into consideration the local context as well. We do waste audits and we track our progress towards our zero waste target. And just in this last year during the pandemic, we've actually shifted our focus, going from waste sorting accuracy to really rethinking how we purchase. So asking folks to think about waste and what will happen to products at the point of purchasing and really getting a little bit more circular. And then we take that feedback from our individual staff campaigns and start to influence our institutional policies as well. So rethinking how we do procurement of goods, how we do our service contracts, and nudge some of our vendors and partners in the future as well. Next slide. But during the pandemic, I think everyone has alluded to some of the changes we've seen in GHG emissions globally. The data has shown that there's been significant reductions in areas that are, anecdotally, you can see that we're not traveling, we're not driving, we're not taking transit as much. So there have been huge reductions in emissions in those areas. But there actually have been some shifts too. There's some inconsistencies in how much it's changed for residential energy, for example. So some of us have kind of this instinctual feeling that energy at home has grown higher since we're all working from home, schooling at home, spending pretty much every hour at home. And in the meantime, our office spaces are still being operated for some limited essential workers. So we're not necessarily seeing that area of emissions go down. And even though the last year has seen overall reduction, the data is pointing, as Tom had said, pointing to without intervention post-pandemic, that there will be rebounds and potentially even higher levels than pre-pandemic. Next slide, please. But what will the post-pandemic workplace look like? One of the questions that our network of 8 different NGOs was considering is if people really want to start hybrid working, working at home some of the week, working in the office, how do we manage and optimize both spaces? And so we conducted a survey with 8 of our different global organizations representing a number of different countries as well. And we found that there's been quite a shift in perception of how people want to work in the future. So pre-pandemic, it was about an average of 1 day per week working at home. Post-pandemic, people are really looking to work nearly 50% of the week at home. 50% of the respondents, we had over 1,300 responses, noted they'd like to work 2 to 3 days at home. But even in the broader picture, 96% wanted to work at least 1 day, with only 4% saying they'd like to go back into the office 100% of the time. And so the data is showing that if we do shift to that, we'll really have to think about how we optimize sustainability and in particular building energy in both spheres, both home and commercial office spaces. Next slide. Similarly, the survey addressed travel questions, travel for business in particular. And this has always been a tricky area for our global organizations to address. I think there's beyond the need to travel, there's also a lot of professional development and cultural considerations that people find travel becomes more and more desirable. But the survey, we asked whether or not people feel that there's opportunity to reduce travel after the pandemic. And perceptions have shifted a lot, and most of this data lined up pretty equally across the different 8 organizations. A lot of folks have responded that there are certain types of functions that they could replace with virtual quite easily and effectively, like conferences, workshops, project management, as well as speaking engagements like this one. And then they noted some challenges in data collection, fundraising, and early relationship building, for example. The survey also covered a few factors that may support future travel interventions or reduction campaigns. In particular, we asked participants what would be a hypothetical commitment you can make post-pandemic to reduce your own business travel. And on average, respondents said about 35%. But in another question, those that said that they felt that they would have peer and supervisor support to reduce travel had almost a 10 to 20% increase in their travel reduction commitments. So really that social norming, peer pressure, and leadership support are really key ingredients to any kind of travel reduction policies. Next slide. So in the greater picture of things, though, we want to make sure any of these future activities line up with broader ambitions for reducing climate change. So at WRI, we've set, and we are co-author of the Science-Based Target Initiative. So one of the things we felt we had to do for our own credibility is set our own science-based targets. So for 2030, we have set GHG emissions reduction targets in line with a limit of a 1.5 degrees Celsius global warming scenario. So that means we're aligned with the Paris Agreement. It's one of the most ambitious GHG emissions reduction targets you can set. And for us, we would have to get to near 50% absolute reduction by 2030. And absolute reduction means we even if we grow, which is something we have done in the last 9 to 10 years, we'll still be looking to really decouple emissions from organizational growth and address some of our highest activities. Next slide. And we know working with our experts, some of the things that we can do that are proven best practices. So energy efficiency of our buildings, negotiating green leases, renewable energy purchasing. We do plan on implementing business travel reduction commitments of 50% and really working on contracts and how we work with our funders, our subgrantees, our corporate vendors, and really addressing our supply chain essentially. But even with all that, we expect there will be some growth and we expect there will be a gap to our target. Next slide. So where we think that gap will be filled is really in collective action. We have, as I mentioned, the survey was done by a small group of NGOs that's part of a larger network of about 50 NGOs and IGOs working on organizational sustainability in our own organizations. And five of them are in the process, WRI included, in approving science-based targets for their organizations. And so collectively, we're seeing these potential impacts growing and scaling amongst our sector. If we were to get the rest of the network, all 50 of us, to do the same by 2030, we're looking at the equivalent amount of emissions reduction to the annual emissions of a whole nation, the island of Kiribati, for example. Next slide. So this is my last slide. Really, in summary, I'd say that in the post-pandemic world, we have to think about a multitude of strategies. There isn't a simple silver bullet kind of response. For our sustainability program, we work at small actions like shifting daily behaviors and low-carbon lifestyles to biking and active commuting, all the way to bigger policy changes around waste, aviation, and building energy efficiency, and really driving that forward with data, measuring our progress and seeing how we can improve impact over time and then eventually spreading and scaling those practices. So that's it for me. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Shengyin. And our final speaker is Richard Graves. Richard, go ahead.
Thanks, Tom, and thanks for everyone who coordinated this webinar. I really, really appreciate it. And it's a very interesting topic to think about. Especially, in the context of my work, directing the work at the Center for Sustainable Building Research. And since I joined the University of Minnesota, we've been trying to integrate regenerative design thinking into our work. And as I started to think about, the topic of the accidental environmental benefits of the pandemic, and then how do we think about those and then figure out strategies to kind of carry them forward. It really had me start to circle back around and come back to some of the core tenets of regenerative design. And I'll kind of walk you through this thinking. So, during the pandemic, we've heard lots of great stories of, nature returning to the city, more birds in San Francisco, views like this image that I have on my cover slide, which is, reduced pollution in Indian cities in the state of Punjab, had a view of the Himalayas appear that hadn't appeared in over 30 years. And next slide. And so, in April, it didn't take very long, maybe a month of shutdown before you started to see some of these kind of accidental and disparate environmental benefits occur, like these views to the Himalayas. And Next slide. And, you know, in addition, you know, we saw the reports of, you know, decreased transportation, decreased industry, and kind of shifting around of energy usage from commercial centers and city centers to our homes create sort of an overall reduction in carbon emissions. And I think a lot of the reporting occurred kind of at the peak of the pandemic. About, you know, at the 16-18 week level that showed this really dramatic reduction. And I think what we've seen as we've started to get back to work, industry has started up again, transportation has started up again, and maybe even as we've heard from other speakers, increasing more than pre-pandemic levels, we're sort of back to climate and carbon emissions as usual. So, you know, really, how much of an accidental benefit are we really seeing? Next slide. And if you take some of those carbon emission numbers, you know, globally, we were down 6%. Interestingly enough, China was barely down at all. They had dramatic shutdowns early in the pandemic, but kind of got back to work, got factories back up and running fairly quickly. So their carbon emission reduction was very low versus the pandemic. And then more dramatic kind of reductions in the United States, Europe, and other parts of the world. So, you know, kind of comes back to the question of how much can we really say that we sort of learned from the pandemic and some of these shifts. If you take other things, next slide, other than carbon emissions, and you look at in December, the American Geophysical Union had a bunch of scientists present some of their analysis of what were some of the environmental benefits and factors they were seeing during the pandemic. And I think what you see, you know, this is a study in San Francisco Bay that was looking at reductions of particulate matter and other pollutants in San Francisco Bay. And this study actually found there wasn't really any reduction in environmental damage or pollution or anything else in San Francisco Bay because of the reduction in commercial activity in the city of San Francisco. And you might ask yourself, why would that be? Surely there should have been a benefit. Well, in the San Francisco Bay case, last spring and summer, there was increased precipitation, tidal forces, wind conditions that overrode the kind of reductions in human impacts to the bay. Other kind of larger scale environmental factors overtook that to create more pollution in the San Francisco Bay example. If you go to the next slide. There we go. So, but however, you know, this is, I think, a story that we all saw in the Hudson River in New York, when you had 2 point something million fewer workers on Manhattan Island, and therefore that much less sewage being treated and sent out into the Hudson, you did see dramatic reductions in pollutants in Western Manhattan and in the Hudson River. So it was true in this case. And if you took, and this is water pollution, if you took deforestation in the rainforest, you see similar disparate results. In Brazil, they actually showed increases in deforestation during the pandemic because nobody was watching anymore. Nobody was there to make sure people weren't doing deforestation. So deforestation levels increased. All that was happening all the while in other countries in South America, like Colombia and others, they saw reductions in deforestation because people were staying home, they weren't working, and they were following the rules and not doing things they shouldn't be doing. So all in all, if you go to the next slide. Next slide. So I think, you know, thinking about these sort of accidental environmental benefits, I'm not so sure we did actually see any of these accidental environmental benefits. And I actually wonder if it's part of our society's search to find a magic bullet or a technological fix to some of our real kind of environmental and social challenges. And so for me, it made me sort of come back and ask the question, you know, what did we really learn? What did I really learn from some of these effects of the pandemic? And so this list for me sort of encapsulate those lessons learned. I think, you know, one of the things that we learned is this separation of nature and humanity to separate systems. We found yet again that we're part of one living system. And, you know, think of those walks that we took a year ago in April and May after we had been cooped up in our houses, and we just needed a connection to a living system, to natural systems, to kind of restore our faith, restore our spirit, and have all of those kind of positive benefits. That mixed with, you know, these living systems continue on and we are inherently linked to them. There is no living system on the planet that's not connected in some way to human activity, and there is a relationship there. I think the second lesson, and I think this is a hopeful lesson, is those few examples of the reductions in carbon emissions, the growth of animals and others coming back into the city, the reduction in water pollution, shows that these living systems are resilient. And if human impacts can back off a little bit, they trend towards self-regulation to health, which is a really hopeful and encouraging sign that if we can sort of shift our way of doing things, maybe we can have some positive effects. However, I think we've also learned, because of this sort of disparate, maybe some benefits occurred, maybe some didn't occur, these systems are complex. And so it's not easy kind of one-off simple solutions that are gonna, there isn't a magic bullet, if you will, that's gonna solve these things. We really have to get to work and do the difficult work to figure things out and establish new relationships between living systems to have these environmental benefits. And then kind of finally back to some of the core ways of thinking, of regenerative thinking, I think we need to kind of reinvest in understanding when we design new products, new systems, new cities, et cetera, we need to acknowledge we're working in a complex living system environment, and that time and space are dynamic. Metrics and success are different in different places. You know, that San Francisco example where you had overall environmental factors affecting water quality, then overcoming the reduction in human impacts versus New York City is a good example. Benefits and impacts can't be externalized. You know, we constantly put boundaries to sit around things to say, you know, we're doing great things for the environment on the campus, on a campus in a city in Minnesota, wherever. But the impacts and benefits are at various scales, global scale, regional scale, et cetera. And though you may be thinking you're externalizing your impacts, they're impacting an environmental or a social system somewhere. And we need to start to make those connections. And I think the other thing is that qualities are as important as quantities. I think we want to get fixated on 50% reductions in carbon emissions by 2030. We kind of have a counting mindset to our culture that if we shift technology, if we shift the way we count things, that'll make all the shifts that we need. And I think, you know, regenerative design makes us think about the qualities of systems, the relationships in systems are just as important, maybe sometimes even more important than how we're counting things. And one of the most important qualities is the quality of our mindset about the way, you know, humans approach social and environmental systems and how we can get into a beneficial relationship with those. And pandemic or no pandemic, and how we go into the future, you know, we really need to focus on, you know, what did we learn during the pandemic? What did we learn about social inequities and other things? And how is that going to change our mindset going forward to have a new approach? Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Richard. We're running a little late, so I think we're going to go into breakout rooms. But Shenzhen, there's a question from Michael Haggins directly to you in the chat, so maybe you want to respond. And meanwhile, Lori, I think you want to send us all to our breakout rooms.
Yes, I could very quickly respond to the question. Oh,
okay, go ahead.
So for the categories one or scope one and two, why not net zero? It's not necessarily to say it's not net zero. Net zero is a tricky categorization. So these would be energy reductions before purchasing renewable energy. And so many organizations are doing renewable energy certificates, renewable energy power purchase agreements, but the goal is to really drive down that energy use as the first step. And then the dovetailing with scope three, also an accounting trickiness, as Richard had noted in his final statement. If we were to do more teleworking, that technically goes into WRI's indirect commute emissions. So it doesn't necessarily solve the whole problem, but looking at it at a broader picture, we don't necessarily want to kind of push the balloon from one end to the other and drive up emissions in residential spheres. So looking at it in a little bigger picture, teleworking alone isn't really enough.
Great. Thank you, Shenzhen. So as we go into breakout rooms, you'll see in the chat that Abby has put the link to note slides. So if you want to take notes for your group to report out, feel free to do so. And I think we're all going to go into breakout rooms at this point. So
exactly. Thank you.
So let's see, people are back. Welcome back, everybody. Let's see. I don't have the list of breakout rooms. Lori, maybe you do, but can we, who is in group one and wants to report out?
So Erin from our group has volunteered to report out.
Okay.
And so we will break out room one.
Go ahead, Erin.
Sure, so we, kind of talked, we took a couple, you know, key points away from each of the speakers' discussions, finding it interesting and valuable the connection with nature that we were all, you know, able to access more over the last year. And I think moving forward, how can we consider, you know, the positive impacts of nature and continue those moving forward? You know, have we grown our bond enough to, you know, care to continue that. Virajita, you know, made a good comment about birds, you know, and birding and their migration patterns, and do those, you know, hobbies and interests. And can they inspire us enough to continue making a difference? And also we found it interesting in Richard's discussion, just kind of the overestimating what the positive impacts really were. And also, I personally had never really considered that, you know, the numerical metrics might not be, you know, enough or really what we need to make a difference. And then Wyman made a good comment of just, you know, from an architectural standpoint, how are we considering, you know, building in the, you know, and in the built environment, you know, all of the impacts that construction has, and really transforming that at every level. Feel free if anyone else from our breakout room wants to add on, but I think that's all I have.
That's great. Good. Thank you, Erin. How about breakout room two? Who wants to speak from that group?
If it's all right, I'm going to nominate Jim since we cut him off right before our final statements on it. Jim's did take some notes though, so to guide
Jim's
you.
Always a good one to nominate. Jim, good to see you.
Good to see you, Tom. A lot of discussion about the polarization politically on this topic and what can be done about that, especially at this late stage. And also discussion about what roles the university can play in helping to educate the broader public, the general public, not just within the realm of architecture, but spreading across other disciplines as well. And I think those are both critical issues that we face as educators and citizens.
Yeah, and given your location in Washington, D.C., it probably seems quite pertinent. Yeah,
very pertinent.
Yeah, great.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. Let's see, our breakout room is going to have Michael Haggins report out. So Michael, go ahead. Oh, Michael, are you on mute maybe? Let's see if he's here. Michael, you're on mute. Well, okay, Michael. No. Well, okay.
If Michael doesn't go, I'm Heather. I can go.
Okay,
I'm
happy to talk. Great, Heather. Thank you.
Okay, sure.
Heather, so, sorry.
Yeah. So we talked about how lower scale buildings was really interesting. Bert has a client right now who is actually making some higher demands for buildings that are being built. We want lower buildings that are more carbon neutral, and not just in the future, but hey, we would love to have it be carbon neutral when the doors open. So speeding up design and being a little bit more green early on. We also talked about how people have mentioned that kind of polarized where it's the people who have the funding and the ability to build these much better, more buildings that are much greener, more sustainable, longer future living. So it's how do you create that legacy for both affordable housing as well as those who have the funds or means to do that. Also looking at how do we get rid of CO2 emissions, the ones that we have now. Maybe it's working, as we say, fixing that current footprint that we have, especially, for example, at the University of Minnesota. We have all these old historical buildings, and how do we renovate and find a way affordably and manage budget planning so that we can fix our existing buildings that we have versus expanding our footprint and constantly building new buildings? That also brings up the topic where we have all these buildings that people are now vacating, especially when you think the huge impacts that are happening as far as in the commercial world and retail world, where all these building spaces are going to start to empty out, and even offices, and how do we repurpose those buildings and again, make those more efficient? And also adaptive reuse, how we're not commonly used things with retail, and this huge shift that we're having between current retail spaces versus the digital world. So this whole idea is thinking about destinations and how we're redesigning, because the retail world is now less about space and more about immersive experience. So how do you get people out to go to the retail world versus digital? And again, that's all design and how we're thinking about that, being smarter about it. So big cultural shifts and changes.
Great, good. Thank you, Heather. Michael, do you want anything to, do you have anything to add?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Sorry about that. Just a couple of points to add on to Heather's comments and underscore the importance of what we hope education to influence opinion with respect to making choices about the future. Because ultimately what we're talking about is a collective choices at a global or at a local level, and every place, and every and personal, and every place in between. And along with that, the importance of the observations that Elizabeth made about equity in the physical environment being a challenge that must be addressed. No easy answers to those, but I think she suggested some framework for thinking about those. And finally, the general observation that the intentionality of travel and the reasons for travel, whether to the office or halfway around the world, are issues that we must, each of us, consider differently than we did in the past. And it's clear that the former patterns, the before time patterns, have changed.
Before times, yes. Thank you, Michael.
Before time.
Yeah, it's okay. Great. How about breakout room four?
Hi, everyone. This is Dan Yutchitz, representing Group Four. Hi, Tom.
Yeah.
So we had a lot of similar conversations to what Group Three did about the commercial real estate world and what's next for development and repurposing and optimizing the use of our downtown core, as we're seeing this shift to more remote work. And then another aspect of that that we focused in a lot on, which relates to some of the work Elizabeth is doing, is what the impacts of sort of detethering people from a downtown commercial core and having the ability to work from anywhere, what are the impacts on those areas where populations might be shifting to? Elizabeth talked about the example of Bemidji and how, you know, now people don't have to live downtown Minneapolis to work a, let's say, a financial job. They can be on a lake in Bemidji. And in doing so, it could have some positive effects environmentally, but it could also have some negative effects, such as increases in cost of housing or just general cost of living increases as this influx of money comes to these communities that aren't necessarily used to that. So those were sort of the main issues we talked about. And then it also got into some conversation about how can technology be equitable as people are sort of relying so much on technology for connections. How can that not be something that is holding certain groups back from being able to participate in public conversations or education, things of that nature?
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you, Dan. Yeah, the new term for these smaller towns that are getting an influx of population is Zoom towns. So, okay, let's see, breakout room five. Who's reporting out from room five?
I could do the report out, or Julia, I don't know if you want to.
Sure, I could do it. We talked a lot about how everyone's working from home, of course, and the implications of that. And then the idea of manufacturing, refocusing on saving energy in plants that one company is having treasure hunts for where you can find energy savings, which I thought was really interesting. Families, one of our members was talking about how interesting it is that families have been able to reconnect in a new way, and that this is really makes opportunities for people to get together without travel as much. So that's another way of thinking about it. Community engagement.
I think Julia froze. Yeah. Richard, do you want to jump
in? I could jump in until she gets unfrozen. So, you know, we talked a lot about community engagement being sort of mixed, where, you know, some community neighborhoods and communities had real challenges that were sort of exposed by everything going to Zoom. And, you know, however, I shared a story of a project that we did in southern Minnesota where we actually found community engagement was increased and a little bit more democratic than how it can be controlled at some time when we do projects in greater Minnesota. So I think it sort of exposed that connection to technology, it should be broadly supported and everyone should be connected to kind of increase democracy to really reap the benefits of the technology. Also, everything online, lots of interesting, you know, sort of in addition, exposed gender inequities and childcare challenges and other things. However, we had a couple of examples of employers who saw productivity increase when we thought it was gonna decrease. But the other kind of negative effect is kind of online engagement, Zoom sort of started to ignore time boundaries of work. So the workday kind of rippled into night and personal time and other times. And so, you know, how do we reconstruct boundaries to kind of take care of our sanity while we do, while we connect with each other online? And then, you know, if we're not doing international travel to save on carbon emissions and we're connecting online, you know, how do you deal with all the time challenges of time zones and other things that, you know, when you try to do that? So.
Great. Good. Thank you, Richard and Julia. Welcome back. And let's go to breakout room six, our final group here. Who wants to report out.
We had the, I think the most international, we had someone from Greece and someone from Nigeria. I don't know if like, but Karen is nominated to report out.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it was a very interesting discussion. We are repeating a lot of what has already been said by other groups, of course. The whole conundrum of working from home, it's not equitable for everyone. Will companies continue to support it? And also the thought of they've been doing it, but how is it affecting corporate culture, I would also add. And then the whole issue of supportive ergonomics and things like visual and acoustical privacy may or may not be accommodated in that home work environment, and of course, technology. And then one of our guests from Nigeria talked about the reduced vehicle fumes and noise. And he said, nobody there though is really tracking the environmental benefits of, you know, these unintended benefits, but he is perceiving the benefits. And we had a little bit of a difficult audio. I think he said a bunch of other good things, but I couldn't make it out. I don't think Abby did either. And then we had a guest also from Greece, and he said that there's a trend of a lot of people moving out of the cities to build single family homes. And he is concerned, he's an architect, and he's concerned about the CO2 emissions. And we asked him if there are any encouragement for people to stay in the city. And he said the government has opened everything up in terms of benefits for people to be able to work from home, no matter what you do. They're trying to accommodate that. And I'm suspecting that's along technological lines and policies and business. And we also talked about, you know, inequities possibly in different communities that are existing. And like many of you said, the concern about the empty buildings in cities. And I know, I think Tom Fisher addressed this in a previous webinar about, you know, how will we use those? And we do need to use those spaces. They embody so much energy and technology and materiality. It would be really not good to waste all that. And companies are struggling with that. And I know from work I do that I don't see people ready to get off the dime and make decisions in corporations. So.
Great. Good.
It was a great discussion.
Yeah. Thanks, Karen. Mm-hmm. And we are just about out of time. I really appreciate everyone's engagement as part of this. Does anyone have any final thoughts or questions in the 2 minutes left? We want to be aware that everyone has many things to do.
Yeah. It's Marvin Meltzer. How are you?
Oh, hi, Marvin. Yeah.
You know, I want to comment a little bit on your Zoom town. I'm up in Connecticut, Northwest Connecticut. My kids sent us up here when the pandemic started, and it's a small community. And what's interesting up here is that a lot of New Yorkers have come up here that, let's say, had summer homes at one time, and now they moved up here permanently. It's had a tremendous impact on the community in different ways. One, the price of real estate has just gone bonkers up. The school system is totally overcrowded because they've come up here and put their kids in the school. And the people who were working here before, for instance, in the supermarket, can't find a place to live anymore. They can't afford it. So they have to move farther out. So it's amazing how this has dramatically changed the culture and the feeling of what the town is about. Wow. In New York, it's just the opposite, you know, that you have all these major buildings that are empty. My feeling is that the value of that real estate is so expensive, it's just hard for me to understand how anybody's going to get in and be able to, for instance, produce affordable housing, which is mainly what I do. And I think that's a big problem that New York is going to go through, which I'm sure other major cities are going to go through also.
Great. Thank you, Marvin. That was sort of a firsthand account of what's going on. I appreciate it.
Yeah, from two. I see it from both ends, from small community to New York City, and the impact that it has, and you know, I stay here most of the time because it's really depressing to go into the city. It's everything's so closed up, especially in Midtown where I am. All these hotels are closed. It's pretty depressing.
Yeah, good. All right. Well, again, thanks, everybody. Abby or Lori, do you want to just talk about what's next?
Sure. I can jump in. This is Lori. So after the event wraps up, you'll be receiving an email from me with some post-event resources that will include a link to the video, transcripts, chat transcripts, and these note slides that you were all generously contributing to. Those of you who want certificates or continuing education credit will see that coming in your email or being posted to your AIA account in the next week, probably pretty quick here, in the next couple of days. And our email will also include these resources that you see on the screen, so you don't have to jump to those right now. And then finally, our next event is coming up, the last one for the spring semester. Design Justice is the topic, and it's on May 26th at 12:30 p.m. Central. And I think we've got the link being posted into chat so that it's active. And if you want to go there and read more, you can also register now. So we hope to see you then. And thanks so much for joining us.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody.